You're listening to the audio production of The Money Hackers, How a Group of Misfits Took on Wall Street and Changed Finance Forever by Daniel P. Simon, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by Jakob Lewis. Foreword read by John Behrens.
Foreword. 17 years ago, when I first came to Bloomberg, I invited Clayton Christensen to come talk about his book, The Innovator's Dilemma, and his perception of how companies reacted, or failed to react, to change. Change in the banking industry has historically moved very slowly. People in finance get nervous about innovation. After all, a bank's first job is not to lose money. Think of all those safe deposit boxes and big, locked vaults. But a company like Bloomberg, a technology company, has no choice but to scan the horizon and try to identify the things that might disrupt our business model. And the disruption we've seen over the past decade has been staggering. People now buy, spend, borrow, and trade instantly, without touching money. Even my local pharmacy in rural Connecticut no longer wants my cash. It only takes payments electronically. This is the fintech revolution. It is a massive shift. It happened overwhelmingly fast, and most people inside the world of banking, distracted by the financial crisis and its aftermath, never saw it coming. Now that it's here, everyone in the business of financial services has to be prepared to accept the fact that they're going to be disrupted. Why wouldn't they be? Nothing is the same. People from their mid-teens to their late 40s are so confident in the power of technology, so fluent in its use, why should they be attached to the old way of doing things? Why should they use a checkbook? Technology is going to continue to change the retail financial services industry. The new, young financial technology companies, the money hackers, are either revolutionizing the old banking models or demolishing them altogether. Everyone inside the financial services industry will have to adapt, even at the expense of their existing businesses and cultures, or risk being left behind. They can start by listening to this book. Peter Grauer, Chairman of Bloomberg LP.
For Charlotte and Eleanor. If money isn't loosened up, this sucker could go down. President George W. Bush, September 25th, 2008. There's an app for that. Apple, January 26th, 2009. Prologue. There's no app for that. Fixing the iPhone's fatal flaw. In March of 2008, while Hank Paulson, Ben Bernanke, Tim Geithner, and all the bankers of New York were glued to their BlackBerry phones in the Bloomberg terminal waiting to see if the failure of Bear Stearns would throw the world into economic collapse, Steve Jobs was on stage at the Town Hall Theater of Apple's Cupertino campus, trying to save the iPhone. The iPhone had been on the market for 8 months. During the first weekend of its release, Apple sold 270,000 of them. And by Labor Day, just 2 months later, that number was up to 1 million. The media was gushing, and by the time Jobs took the stage in March, the Jesus phone had already captured 28% of the smartphone market share. Things weren't exactly going bad for the iPhone. But it did have one big problem, and the people in the room at Apple's spring event knew it. It didn't have apps. When the iPhone launched in 2007, all of its software came pre-installed and hermetically sealed. There was no way for a user to add apps. At the time, Jobs wasn't trying to create a new and revolutionary mobile computing platform. He was just trying to make a better phone. He said this no fewer than 5 times during the famous 2007 keynote, where he introduced the product. Today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone. Jobs hated the existing market of cell phones. He hated the way they looked. He hated their software. He hated their clumsy user experience. This sentiment only deepened after Apple tried partnering with Motorola on a phone they called the Rocker, a repackaged E398 candy bar phone that could sync with iTunes, which sold so badly that it was removed from Motorola's lineup only a few months later. "I'm sick and tired of dealing with bozo handset guys," he told his internal team. He knew he could do better. In order to compete with other smartphones, Apple's phone would need to have texting, email, a camera, a way to manage its photos, and a web browser. And Jobs wanted all of these features to be better than anything else on the market. And because music was a core part of Apple's business at the time, he also wanted this phone to double as an iPod. Finally, because he was Steve Jobs, he wanted all these things to operate together beautifully. It was a huge design challenge that the team decided to solve by thinking of the new device less like a phone and more like a scaled-down computer, capable of running a lightweight version of Apple's Mac OS. But putting a computer in everyone's pocket was a consequence of their original goal, not the goal itself. The goal was simply to make the best phone the world had ever seen. The team added more hardware to the device, including Wi-Fi and an experimental new touchscreen, and they enhanced the phone with other software capabilities. Widgets, they called them. A clock, a calculator, a way to check the weather, a way to check the stock market. They even worked with Google to add a map widget, despite the fact that their device had no GPS. These were, as far as Jobs was concerned, just extras. The killer app, he told his audience, is making calls. He first unveiled the iPhone at Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference. The people in the room were software engineers, and Jobs showed them a mobile computer platform that was more advanced than anything they had seen. If he had hoped to whet their appetites, it worked. Then he told them they wouldn't be able to write software for it. He didn't want anyone other than Apple creating software for the phone. Jobs didn't trust third-party developers to offer the same level of aesthetically pleasing and stable experiences that Apple programmers could produce, Cal Newport wrote in the New York Times. He was convinced that the phone's carefully designed native features were enough. Developers disagreed. They saw in the iPhone something that Jobs himself didn't quite yet see, that the untapped opportunities for a mobile, internet-capable computer were enormous. Apple wasn't going to invite them to write software for it, but that didn't mean they wouldn't try to crash the party. The iPhone released to the world on June 29, 2007, and within a week, hackers had found their way into an iPhone's file system, installed a custom ringtone, something the original iPhone didn't allow, and posted a video on YouTube to prove they'd done it. The age of iPhone jailbreaking had begun. Savvy coders cracked into their phone's software to get it out of the jail of Apple's restrictions and to experiment with and personalize the device and invent whatever they felt the out-of-the-box iPhone lacked. Some wanted to unshackle their phone from its exclusive link to AT&T's 2G Edge network and switch it to another cell provider. Some wanted to add new capabilities, the ability to sync with Windows instead of just Macs, or the ability to place calls over the internet. Some just enjoyed the challenge of breaking into the revolutionary technology. But underneath the jailbreaking was a subtextual message to Apple. This phone is ours, not yours. There are things we want it to do, and you can't stop us. A month after the iPhone's release, unsanctioned developers were releasing the first native third-party iPhone apps and posting them online. In iPhone iOS 1.0, Apple didn't even have a effing game, right? Complained software developer Jay Freeman. Every other phone had a copy of Snake. Every phone had a copy of Hangman. Freeman, also known by his hacker name Sorik, soon became one of the most famous jailbreakers of all when, on February 28, 2008, he released Cydia, a centralized platform for distributing and downloading third-party software for jailbroken iPhones. Soon, people were downloading installers for new iPhone features, many of which Apple later adopted, including ringtones, do not disturb, and cut and paste. And apps. Lots of apps. Cydia, named after the worm that eats its way through an apple, was effectively the iPhone's first app store. Apps were new to the iPhone ecosystem, but the idea of them wasn't new to the software community. It was at the core of one of the oldest and most important modern computer platforms, Unix. The creators of Unix, Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie, believed code should be lightweight, modular, and focused, and they designed their system around what came to be known as the Unix philosophy. Write computer programs that do one thing and do it well. As desktop computers grew more powerful and as software companies grew more reliant on repackaging their existing product lines, software became subject to feature bloat, adding more capabilities and complicated code with each successive and often crash-prone release. But smartphones like the iPhone didn't have anywhere near the computing power of a desktop machine, and suddenly programmers were facing new, or rather old, technological constraints. Limited memory, small screens, and slow download times. If developers wanted to create software that would improve an iPhone, they would need to get back to Unix's original philosophy. Think lean and do one thing very well. Unix is the platform that sits underneath Apple's own operating system, and anyone writing software for the Mac OS would have had an inherent understanding of the Unix philosophy. The Unix philosophy became the app philosophy, too. Apple did everything in its power to fight back against the jailbreakers and the Cydia community. Its internal iPhone team kept patching security holes, making jailbreaking harder, and sometimes even bricking the jailbroken phones, rendering them not just inoperable, but also, because they'd been intentionally hacked, out of warranty. "We want to make great products," Jobs said, justifying his tight control over the iPhone platform. "Not crap like Android." But after each software patch, the jailbreakers found a new way to crack the iPhone, and the cycle continued. Apple was in an arms race against its own customers. Technology writer Saul Hansel commented, "There is something futile about the way Apple appears to be fighting some of its most ardent fans, those who want to use the full capabilities of the iPhone." Jobs was losing control of his ecosystem, and he knew it. He decided it was time to get ahead of the curve. On March 6, 2008, 8 days before the final collapse of Bear Stearns, at an iPhone event in the Town Hall Theater, Apple released an SDK, a software development kit that gave its developer community, finally, a legitimate way to write software for the iPhone. 4 months later, on July 10th, and a day before the FDIC seized the mortgage company IndyMac, Apple launched the App Store, a way for those developers to distribute their software to iPhone users worldwide. Steve Jobs had ceded total control. The future of the iPhone and mobile computing was no longer up to Apple. Now it was up to people everywhere, and their imaginations. Who knew that it would start a financial revolution? Author's note. When I was 13, my dad got very sick and lost his job. My family's world, which had been built on the cheap credit of the late 1980s, fell apart. We had to sell a lot of things. I got pulled out of my school, and my glamorous mom traded her sable coat for a polyester apron and took a job stacking boxes at the local supermarket. Dad went on benefits and drove a dry cleaning truck to make ends meet. People have faced greater hardships, but the experience left me with a lifetime of anxiety and a particularly complex relationship with money. I panic irrationally about basic things, like toothpaste running out. I buy more groceries than we can eat. I've never had a credit or store card, and my savings are mostly in cash, which means I sat out on one of the greatest bull runs in stock market history. The irony is that I chose to make a career out of telling stories about money, and I've made a lot of money doing it. And as I've become more successful, the disconnect between my thriving professional interests and my personal financial infecundity has become more acute. I can tell you whether the Fed will raise or lower interest rates, but the thought of interest on a credit card leaves me in a cold sweat. I can explain how mortgage securitization led to the financial crisis, but the prospect of taking a mortgage for myself terrified me so much I wound up renting for 10 years longer than I should have. A few years ago, the exasperated co-founder of my company finally stood over my desk and set up a 401k for me. Oscar Wilde said, "Everything in the world is about sex, except sex. Sex is about power." Money works the same way. Money is about literally everything except physical units of currency. It's about security, status, family, success, failure, health, and yes, sex. Everything except the numbers in the bank ledger. People are challenged by money not because they can't do basic math, but because they're frozen by their own psychology, by the burden of everything that money represents. Traditional finance works great for those who are born wealthy or financially confident. It sucks for the rest of us. This book is about a group of people who felt the same. The entrepreneurs profiled in this book all saw something fundamentally broken about the financial industry, beyond the obvious flaws that led to the crisis of 2008, that it had lost touch with its roots, yet simultaneously failed to keep up with the digital age, that it didn't have a solution for the majority of regular people who are struggling with money issues, that while new tech giants were talking about...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.